Hello, welcome to the Self-Learning Podcast by Dr. Sushma Singh. Let us start discussion on Chapter 3, Election and Representation. Have you ever played chess? What would happen if the black knight suddenly started moving state rather than 2.5 squares? Or what would happen if in a game of cricket there were no umpires? In any sport, we need to follow certain rules. Change the rules and the outcome of the game would be very different. Similarly, a game needs an impartial umpire whose decision is accepted by all the players. The rules and the umpire have to be agreed upon before we begin to play a game. What is true of a game is also true of elections. There are different rules on systems of conducting elections. The outcome of the election depends on the rules we have adopted. We need some machinery to conduct the elections in an impartial manner. Since these two decisions need to be taken before the game of electoral politics can begin, these cannot be left to any government. That is why these basic decisions about the elections are written down in the constitution of a democratic country. In this chapter, we shall study the constitutional provisions regarding elections and representations. We shall focus on the importance of the method of election chosen in our constitution and the implications of the constitutional provisions regarding impartial machinery for conducting elections. We shall also look at some suggestions for amending the constitutional provisions in this respect. After reading this chapter, you would understand different methods of elections, the characteristics of the system of election adopted in our country, the importance of the provisions for free and fair elections, and the debate on electoral reforms. Now let us discuss the topic elections and democracy. Let us begin by asking ourselves two simple questions about elections and democracy. Can we have democracy without holding elections? Can we hold elections without having democracy? Let us have a discussion in the classroom on both these questions by using examples from whatever we have learned so far in the previous classes. The first question reminds us of the necessity of representation in a large democracy. All citizens cannot take direct part in making every decision. Therefore, representatives are elected by the people. This is how elections become important. Whatever we think of India as a democracy, our mind invariably turns to the last elections. Elections have today become the most visible symbol of democratic process. We often distinguish between the direct and indirect democracy. Direct democracy is one where the citizens directly participate in the day-to-day decision-making and in the running of the government. The ancient city-states in Greece were considered examples of direct democracy. Many would consider local governments, especially Gram Sabha, to be the closest examples of the direct democracy. But this kind of direct democracy cannot be practiced when a decision has to be taken by lakhs and crores of people. That is why rule by the people usually means rule by the people's representatives. In such an arrangement, citizens choose their representatives, who in turn are actively involved in governing and administering the country. The method followed to choose these representatives is referred to as an election. Thus, the citizens have a limited role in taking major decisions and in running the administration. They are not very actively involved in making of the policies. Citizens are involved only indirectly through their elected representatives. In this arrangement, where all major decisions are taken by elected representatives, the method by which people elect their representatives becomes very important. The second question reminds us of the fact that not all elections are democratic. A large number of non-democratic countries also hold elections. In fact, non-democratic rulers are very keen to present themselves as democratic. They do so by holding election in such a way that it does not threaten their rule. Can you think of some examples of such non-democratic elections? What do you think would distinguish a democratic from a non-democratic election? What can be done to ensure that elections in a country would be conducted in a democratic way? This is where constitution comes in. The constitution of a democratic country lays down some basic rules about elections. The details are usually left to be worked out by laws passed by the legislatures. These basic rules are usually about who is eligible to vote, who is eligible to contest, who is to supervise elections, how do the voters choose their representatives, how are the votes to be counted and representatives elected. Like most democratic constitutions, the Constitution of India answers all these questions. As you can see, the first three questions are about ensuring that elections are free and fair and can thus be called democratic. The last two questions are about ensuring a fair representation. In this chapter, you will consider both these aspects of the constitutional provisions about elections. Now, let us wind up the session and thank you very much for engaging yourself with the self-learning podcast.